Hey, welcome back to Sci-Fi Cross Sections, the podcast dedicated to everything science fiction. It's me, your boy, Ben Young, filling in for your other boy, Colin Brandon. And with me tonight is...
It's Mark. Mark the Botker man, Botker.
I'm Bill Jarvis.
Andrew's back.
Tonight we're talking about the hit 2002 sci-fi film Signs, directed by M. Night Shyamalan. Produced by M. Night Shyamalan and Kathleen Kennedy. The only reason I bring up produced by is because Kathleen Kennedy was a producer on this.
I didn't know it.
Written by M. Night Shyamalan, starring Mel Gibson, Joaquin Phoenix, Rory Culkin, and Abigail Breslin. And music by James Newton Howard. That's really all that matters. Had a budget of $72 million. Box office? Do you think it doubled it?
Tripled. I would say so, yeah.
It did? Yeah, tripled it. I think it almost quadrupled. It definitely did. $408.2 million box office globally. People liked this. They liked crop circles back in the day. That was a cool thing.
They liked
aliens, and strangely enough, at one point, they liked Mel Gibson. So... people liked this.
It's what women want.
Hello, if you are a woman listening to this, hello.
Great. Good one. That was a good one. All right. Woo! All right, we're off to the races. Let's talk about Signs. Six months after the death of his wife, a former priest tries to hold his family together amidst an alien invasion while struggling with his own loss of faith.
Wow.
Yeah.
Did you like that? I was so good. This is concise.
I mean, thank you. Broadly, the theming of the movie is pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, you got an alien invasion, priest doesn't believe in God anymore. The aliens are God, they come to him, and they tell him to kill his son, as God did to that one guy's
Abraham.
Dad.
Abraham and Isaac.
Sure. Totally.
The Binding of Isaac, it's a famous story Edmund McMillan.
I call them Icarus and that one guy's dad.
Poseidon.
But, Signs. Ooh, did we like this? Did we not like this? I thought it was fine.
Is this your first time watching?
That's good for, no, that's good sci-fi, bad sci-fi. I'll see you next year.
Bye.
I had seen this before. I saw this when I was a wee one, probably about the time it came out. So I'd say like 10, 11, 12. It scared me. It spooked me. I remember when the scene when Meryl's up against the TV and he's like, "Vamanos, children, vamanos," and the alien steps out from the fence. That spooks me. It's a scary, scary little time. When you see it, you know, it's scary. It's a good design. But I think just opening up a topic of conversation, it shocks me that we are so hard on The Happening and not hard on this one at all, which has all of the same crimes that The Happening does as far as its actors go.
Did we review The Happening?
No, I don't mean us in general. I just mean society.
I don't know the hate behind The Happening.
Okay, well, when people talk about The Happening, the first thing they like to reference is Mark Wahlberg's delivery of this line.
Oh, wait, I think I know what you're talking about.
Where he's like, "Everybody's dying."
Oh, I thought you were talking about the, "What? No."
That one, too, just all of them.
Maybe he just sucks at acting.
What? No.
Well, but the delivery in this movie is the same way for Mel Gibson, and this is undoubtedly Joaquin Phoenix's worst performance of his life. I think there's something toxic about working with Knight. I think Knight doesn't know what humans act like, and so he directs based on that, like what he thinks humans act like, because he is an alien.
His scene in the car could have been a little better, although he did, he was properly dazed. I feel like it was more what it was supposed to come off as, but it almost missed that mark still.
Yeah, I mean, he's also not an actor by any means. He does act in it. He tries his hand at Tarantino-ing it.
But, I think he just throws himself into the movie to explain the plot. Because he shows up and he's like, the aliens are allergic to water. I'm leaving to go to the water planet.
So, one thing I was thinking about is that his character, Knight writes the movie. So, as a writer, writers feel like, even though we're putting these characters through this, it's our decision to do it, but it's not our decision. The script writes itself. You know what I'm saying? But writers often have a complex where it's like, I don't want to do this to this character. I like this character too much. I don't want them to go down this road. And I find it funny that, like, here he is, the writer who sends Mel Gibson down this awful 6 months, the worst 6 months of his life, I assume. And then he also plays the character in the script who also sends him down the worst 6 months of his life, I assume. So I don't know if he chose to play that role because he felt a connection to the role as a writer, but I've felt that before when I've written, where I'm just like, I don't, you know, I feel guilty for what I do to the characters. And so I'm sure that's kind of what it felt like to me.
That's really interesting. I hadn't even thought about that.
Thanks, I'm full of them.
Wait. Also, I have a question. Do you call him M. Night Shyamalan, or do you call him M. Night?
He's saying M. Night like M-bop.
Why?
Yeah, that's
why
what I was thinking
too. In a joke that got old like six times ago.
What? That's not the human being way of saying that. I don't know.
Ben is revealing himself to, in fact, also not be a human, but be an alien from a warring faction to M. Night.
It's true. I'm here to take him down. It turns out he's just been taking himself down, so it's been a pretty easy mission.
Yeah, I was gonna say he's kind of self-destructed.
It's an Invaders in shit.
Yeah, as far as what you were saying about The Happening, I haven't seen it, so I couldn't tell you.
Me neither.
But maybe it's just due to people being aware of some of those things after they've seen them, you know, three or four more times after Signs. I'm not sure. I haven't actually seen this in a long time, and I remember liking it quite a bit, and it held up better than I expected it to. I thought I'd find more flaws in it, but there were a lot more things that I think I missed initially, or maybe just didn't remember over the last, well, almost 20 years. I probably seen it around 2010 sometime again. But, I don't know, I enjoyed it a lot more than I was expecting to on rewatch. And there were some cool little things that I missed before. And some funny things, too. Like the, when he goes in the military office, the recruitment office. And the guy's telling him about probing as a military tactic. I thought that was pretty funny.
It seems so bizarre. And that's like, that's, I guess, like, I don't know. I've never seen The Sixth Sense because I never saw a point. Like, everyone and their parents ruined the movie. And, you know, the movie had come out well beyond the point where I was, like, you know, able to watch it. So, like, I get it. Like, I'm not, like, blaming people for spoiling it. But, like, I never saw it, so I don't know if this is always the case. But he always, Knight seems to always have these, like, weird tonal shifts throughout his movie that will either play really well for him or not, depending on his script, I think. Because it seems to always be the case, right? Like, he always, even in, like, from what I remember in Devil, like, which he did not direct, but he wrote, it also seems to have like these weird tonal shifts through it, in which case it worked for that one. But in Signs, people liked it. It worked. And then in The Happening, no one liked it. And then The Last Airbender, no one liked it. And I don't know.
Nobody liked anything about that movie.
Hmm?
Nobody liked The Last Airbender at all, in general.
Right. Well, no, for sure.
There was nothing to like.
Well, like, I've always felt like when it comes to M. Night, there's not just one thing you hate about his movies. It's nothing, there's never like a deal breaker. It's always a compound of issues where it's like, okay, well, the score sucked. Okay, well, the acting sucked. Okay, well, the script sucked. Okay, well, the direction sucked. And it's like here, the acting sucks. The writing's not great. But people like it because it's very well paced. It's very suspensefully paced.
Yeah. I think he got really lucky with Sixth Sense in this movie, and then it just went to shit because, like, things like The Lady in the Water. I don't know if anybody, or Lady in the Water. Yeah, I was going to say it's super fucking weird. And it's the same idea as you said, the weird tonal shifts in the middle of the movie, and you're like, what the fuck's going on? If you're really paying attention, you're like, what the fuck's going on here? With these characters. But so there was some sort of trivia that I found on here that I thought was really cool. Casting wise, so Mark Ruffalo was supposed to be in this movie. He's supposed to play he was supposed to be the part of the brother. And
he's supposed to be Meryl.
And he apparently had a brain tumor that turned out to be benign at the time. But yeah, it's very interesting. I had no idea about that. And oh, wow. I think I could see it. I could definitely see him playing a better Meryl.
Hmm. Yeah, no, I love Mark Ruffalo. I think he probably would have done better, but I don't know, because the script's just bad. Like, you could tell Joaquin's trying, but his character is so poorly written and so just, like, stupid that, like, he can't help but make it come
it's
off
true.
As corny. He has no choice.
What do you dislike so much about the way they wrote his character?
I think the whole movie is just camp. Like, don't get me wrong, I ended up enjoying it more than I thought I would going into this rewatch, because it had been a while, but the movie is just pure camp. I think the uncertainty is what scared us as kids, because as an adult, I can't help but laugh at every single scene, except the scene where Morgan kills the dog. That's fucked up. But everything else was just like even this big climactic moment where you know, the whole swing away Meryl thing is like supposed to be like empowering for these characters, and it's corny. It's stupid. I can't take it seriously. And part of the reason might be because of Scary Movie 3. Scary Movie 3 might have ruined this movie for me.
I haven't seen any of the Scary movies.
Scary Movie 3 has some really wonderful everything that's not signs in Scary Movie 3 sucks, but all of their signs parodies are awesome. The one thing that, like, I couldn't focus at all during the scene with where he's talking to his wife at the car where she's pinned, because I kept thinking about the scene in Scary Movie 3 where Charlie Sheen comes up and he's like, she's like, you're not going to be able to talk to her. And he's like, I don't understand. She's like, she's split in two halves. Yeah, so, and he pulls out a donut and a hot dog and he like sticks it. He's like, will this still work? She's like, no.
Oh my God.
No. And he's like, I still don't get it. And she takes the hot dog and breaks it in half. And he goes, oh. So, like, I don't know. Maybe parodies have ruined all of the dramatic tension in these movies for me.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of parody. Let's get rid of it.
Of your humor is parody.
My humor? Yeah, I love me. That's not true.
But there are interesting points to talk about with signs too.
Yeah, have you guys heard the theory that it's not about aliens at all, but it's about demons?
I have not.
No, I haven't heard that.
Am I the only one, Mark? Have you heard this theory?
No, I haven't heard it.
So the theory kind of goes that obviously, the father is the Mel Gibson character is a lapsed Episcopal priest, and kind of the idea, I guess, behind this whole thing is that these demons are like sent to Earth, and like the daughter, like her whole weirdness is that she's got like some kind of divinity in her, which is why the water actually hurts these, because she's like taking little sips and blessing the water inadvertently right. turning it into holy water. So it's not actually that the quote unquote aliens are allergic to water. It's that the demons are averse to holy water. And there's some other things. I haven't read into the whole theory in a while, but that's kind of the gist of it.
Interesting.
Yeah.
That's a really interesting... Sorry, go ahead.
There were some other things, like the lights in the sky.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that...
Isn't that like a reference to the rapture? Sorry. Like, lights in the sky?
Yeah, it could be.
I suppose it could be. Ray Reedy also recognized the bit about the water.
Mm-hmm.
I think he just was basing it on a rumor, right?
Well,
yeah, could be.
Cause he did say I was thinking about it, and he mentioned like that he noticed where all of these events were happening were away from water, all the crop circles.
Okay. I like that theory a lot because it actually kind of makes Bo not pointless, I guess.
Like, yeah,
her whole thing where like it does seem like she has some sort of divinity about her, but it never pans out, and so it just comes off as silly. So that theory, that read of the movie, actually gives her some purpose, which is nice.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't she say something about I had a dream like this a couple times?
She claims she dreams a lot of events in the movies, but they never turn out the way she was expecting them to. Assuming because that every time there's like some big thing that's coming up that she says that like she dreamed about, it's a moment of faith. It's a moment of whether which man is Mel Gibson going to be. He needs to decide right now. So that's probably... She's probably seeing the bad endings of everything.
Got it. Another thing I saw, I don't know, M. Night Shyamalan seems to have a weird thing about water as a weapon, which is weird, very interesting.
Unbreakable.
So like Unbreakable, obviously, Lady in the Water. I mean, it's like he seems to have this kind of obsession with water. It's very interesting because water as a weapon. I don't know. When we see these themes of water as a weapon, because it seems to be like a thing that he loves to do with this.
Well, apart from a lot of people's like, well, I shouldn't say a lot of people, but apart from using it as kind of, you know, a sense of fear of swimming or fear of, you know, like Jaws or something like that, it is otherwise usually synonymous with life or, you know, lifeblood.
True. Life and death. I mean, water gives, water takes away.
Yeah.
Water.
Everyone
world.
Who's drank water has died. So.
Are we going to cover Water World on, 100% true. On this show? Covering that? Covering Water World on this show?
Oh, hell yeah.
Maybe someday.
The classic blockbuster.
Russell Crowe, Cameron Diaz, Ethan right? Hawke.
I don't think any of that is correct.
Now we need a movie. We need a sci-fi movie with those three actors in it. Now.
Yeah, I'm
down with that. It's a good cast.
Wasn't I like Werner Herzog in it too?
Herzog.
Yeah, I think so.
I'm pretty sure
he played the professor.
Yeah,
yeah, played the professor. Mm-hmm. Cameron Diaz played Marianne. This is a sci-fi reboot of Gilligan's Island. Starring Ray Liotta as Gilligan.
It's so interesting. Can you open up your window?
This is a really weird joke. Let's get back on track.
Alright. So this that confirms that M. Night Shyamalan is an alien. An anti-water alien.
Mm-hmm. So, an anti-water alien, yeah.
Yeah, an alien that can't look down at a planet and go, huh? Hey, is that stuff that hurts us down there? Okay. And they're like, no, it's fine.
Like, yeah, I was like, if we were exploring space and we were like, hey, maybe we should wear suits. And they're like, well, all of the atmosphere is fine. We can breathe the atmosphere. Okay, cool. But there's sulfur pools.
Captain, this planet is 75% hydrochloric acid.
Oh, put us right down in that acid pit.
We'll be fine.
No,
we'll
you know fine. What, though? We would go down.
Yeah, we definitely would.
We would.
We would.
They did.
I feel like that's, I mean, I feel like that's an OSHA fine waiting to happen, though.
The book that, obviously, it was a lot of speculation and things like that. Apart from it being kind of the another like divine set piece that was handed to them, they just happened to get the one copy of that book in at the store, and they wound up with it. But it had, that was one of the things they talked about, and it was, you know, them coming to take the planet because theirs had become uninhabitable to them.
Sure.
So if it was out of desperation and there were other things that were positive about the planet, then maybe it was worth it.
But that's we also do know they weren't there to take the planet. We found that out at the end. They were there to take the people, which honestly backs up Miller's demon theory even more.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's something I was thinking about the whole time, because I don't remember all the twists and turns, you know, going into this. And I was very confused as to why they would even want a planet like this, because it is virtually uninhabitable for them. Like, the shit that hurts them falls from the sky.
Yeah,
like,
true.
They can't live here.
It's present in the air in most places.
And they show up without their galoshes.
But it turns out they were taking people, is what someone had said on the radio toward the end and when everyone was coming out of the basement.
Got it. Is it for delicious human meat? Is that why that's happening?
I assume it's to power their computer simulation.
Oh, okay.
I did. I really liked the line where after Mel Gibson gets back from Ray Reddy's house, and he says the bit about the water, and his kid's like, that seems kind of unfounded. been spouting all the information from the book. That's like, okay.
Like, no, that's, I laughed at that too. Rory Culkin and Abigail Breslin kill it in this movie. Like, I'm sitting here like trashing on the acting, but the kids do a really good job, because the kids just know what they're supposed to do. Read lines, act like kid. Like, that's their job. That you can give them some very basic emotions, but you can't be nuanced like Knight's trying to be with the older actors, where it's like, be baffled, be this, be that. Like, you don't get that. You just get kids. And these are two just legitimately raw, talented kid actors who, you know, we have both gone on to great things, and it's shown in here. And I love both of them. They're,
I know,
the best
Abigail Breslin, but who's Vandalay Culkin?
Rory Culkin.
Yeah, he's
Macaulay Culkin's brother, but I don't know what else he's been in.
Yeah.
Roy Culkin was in Scott Pilgrim.
Who was he? Young Neil?
Oh, he was, no, the older, the...
Yeah. He was the friend, right?
Or was that Kieran Culkin?
Steven Stills?
Steven, no.
No, he was, what's
Gideon
his name?
Graves.
The gay roommate.
No,
never mind. That was Kieran Culkin.
How many Culkins are there?
Is that another brother?
There's three. There's Rory, Kieran, and Macaulay.
Also, why can't the parents name their kids anything normal?
Shane Culkin, Dakota Culkin, Macaulay Culkin, Kieran Culkin, Quinn Culkin, and Christian Culkin.
They had it right, and then they lost the plot, and then they kind of got back to normal.
The more I said Culkin, the weirder it got.
Yeah.
Kieran's on, he's on Castle Rock, which is that one show.
Game of Thrones spinoff?
No. It's that one show.
I never saw it.
It's the Stephen King show, where it's like Stephen King's universe.
The Stand.
He's in Scream 4 as Charlie Walker.
Didn't see it.
So good. Oh, very good. I forgot that was him.
Igby Goes Down.
Igby Culkin?
He was in the Waco miniseries.
Ooh.
Thank you for joining the Culkin cast.
Welcome to the cast where we list movies that Andrew hasn't seen before. Godfather Part 1, 2, and 4 to that
list.
Why
do you ask things you don't want the answers to?
I didn't ask anything.
I don't think anybody asked anything.
Yeah.
Am I alone?
Who are you people?
I don't know.
Is this just Ben with four voices?
I think so. Wait.
Phil, say something only Ben would say.
Event Horizon's the worst.
Why you gotta put me on the spots like this?
No,
hold on. Let me go write this out. I'm gonna go brainstorm.
You're a real person. We know you're a real person now. Okay, so religion. Let's talk about it. Because that's the basic focus of Signs. It's a sci-fi film, yes, but it's a sci-fi film that is to look at... For those... There's a visual.
For those of you who aren't
right
on,
now,
on this Discord call right now, Bill's walking around looking for SpaghettiOs in his back room.
Okay, wait. I got it. Okay. It's because I'm fat. But that doesn't work anymore.
No. I haven't said that since high school.
Fuck. Okay, I'll go. That was you know my what? Catchphrase I'm going to go back to the drawing board.
All right.
He's walking around again. Oh,
he's going to continue the visual gag while we talk about religion and how... Science uses sci-fi, science fiction, its genre, to actually talk about religion, which is pointedly not a science fiction topic. It is in the context of how humans deal with religion, of course, though. So, Miller, I know out of everyone here, you're the only guy who, like, does that shit, so...
Yeah, I probably am the most religious out of this entire... Except for Mark. Mark's a little more religious than I am.
Okay, so, but he believes, he worships, you know, Cthulhu. We need to know...
Mark's never read a fucking Lovecraft novel in his life.
We need to know all about this God guy. Uh-huh. What's up with him?
Well, it isn't specifically about God, but I think the only thing that actually ties this movie to sci-fi is the fact that the monsters in this movie may or may not be aliens. I mean, if they were demons, then this is just firmly not sci-fi. If this was anything other than aliens, then it would not be sci-fi. Nothing else science fiction really happens in this movie to me. They get the book by that guy, and they wear the tinfoil hats, and that's about it. Well, I mean, what do you want to know about Gad? You know, I mean, he does a lot of things. You know, I mean, he's what's your question?
Well, it's not really a question. It's just like, you know, most of the critical analysis of this film would revolve around, I suppose, it centers around Mel Gibson's main point.
Right, his loss of faith.
But not just his loss of faith, his speech that he gives to Meryl when Meryl is worried about the lights over Mexico City.
Mm-hmm.
He tells Meryl that there's two types of people in this world. There's the type of person that will look at those lights and will be skeptical about it, but they'll think it's something, they'll think it's nothing, they'll think it's the end of the world, they think it won't be. But no matter what they think, they're going to be afraid because they don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the other type of person who sees it as a miracle. Mm-hmm. They still don't know. They don't know what it is. All they know is that whatever it is, it's a miracle, which is... It reaffirms their faith and makes them feel comforted.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the movie is a battle of what kind of person Graham, Mel Gibson's character, is. And I don't know. This seems to be the only point of topic we could talk about when it comes to how a sci-fi challenges faith, I guess.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we could just call it.
Sure. No, I mean
this is definitely, yeah.
Oh, sorry. Go on, Bill.
No, I was going to switch gears just a second, but I was like, what I was going to say is this is definitely one of those things where I could definitely probably talk about this if I forget about sci-fi. I mean, this is like, I'd say the biggest point is that this is examining faith in general, because I mean, the definition of faith is belief without evidence. And it's like, it's understanding and believing in something and trusting in something rather than touching, feeling, sensing it. You have a belief within you as a human being rather than seeing something and measuring it and understanding it. You have a faith within you. So I think that's one of the biggest sort of messages to take away from this.
Yeah, really well said, Bill. Furthermore to that, let us not be remiss in, you know, misremembering that, you know, science, and therefore to a certain extent I think we could extrapolate science fiction, is it's not a system of belief, it's a method of figuring things out. You know, I mean, the reason that we don't, you know, make sacrifices to the god of rain anymore is because we figured out how rain works. You know, we don't have to kill, you know, the firstborn calf anymore in order to make things rain. You know, people
wait, we don't
Mark You're a vegetarian. Oh, hey, you haven't been doing that anyway. No wonder it doesn't rain at your house. No, I mean we don't have to, you know, we don't have to appease those gods anymore. You know, we figured it out to a certain extent, and you know, who knows what we'll figure out in the future, you know? I mean, but you know, it's funny. Religion is, it's a list of rules, and there's a lot going on, and a lot of it's contradictory and stuff like that. So, I mean, I think people really have to kind of come to their own conclusions, make their own decisions, you know, I mean, examine what is available and kind of go from there. I mean, it's not like the scientific method where you can, you know, put religion in a beaker, swirl it around, put a little flame underneath it, and come out with the answer. I think it's different, and
have you tried that?
I haven't. No. Do you know how expensive glassware is?
And while we're in the middle of a joke, I wanted to cut in really quick and just say it's not a topic of skepticism versus religion. It's a topic of skepticism versus faith, which I think faith and religion are two very different,
extremely different things. I mean, just think of how many religions there are in general. I mean, this movie obviously deals particularly with a certain sect of Christianity, but obviously there are many religions out there that, you know, maybe there's one out there for you.
I did want to talk about that difference that you were mentioning, Ben, because I think that part of the driving force behind this theme is that, especially when it comes to space travel and extraterrestrials, I feel like faith is involved in that a lot, and in sci-fi as a theme in general. So I think that it's an interesting approach to put those comparatively so close together, religion, demons, and aliens. I think it was very purposeful. I do like the way that it came out in the story in general, and the way they discussed it too was very interesting. They touched on it very lightly a lot, but they had a couple scenes where they got into it a little more, like on the couch and. But yeah, I definitely think that in general with aliens, you know, or even what, X-Files.
I was thinking of the X-Files when you were mentioning that. Yeah.
I think that's a common theme in sci-fi as it is.
That's a really wonderful point. This whole argument that Graham makes makes me think about argument that is made in another sci-fi TV show which came out after Signs, a little ditty called Lost, which I want to do so bad. I want to talk about Lost for 10 hours. But the kind of driving conflict behind the first three seasons is the man of science versus the man of faith. Two born leaders who find themselves on this island, one reluctant, the other less so, and they find themselves consistently at odds throughout the story based on various parts of the island, based on things happening with other characters. They always seem to find themselves at odds. And the funniest thing is, and many characters often mention it, is that if these two would just sit down and talk more rather than argue, is they'd find a lot more in common than they think. And I think that's always kind of been the case with the argument of science versus faith. You know, like more recently in our history, Catholicism has kind of opened their mind more to more scientific explanations in partnership with their idea of God, you know. So that just goes to show, like, You could accept viewpoints of different kinds, work it into your own philosophy. There is no one correct answer. I myself am even just, I'm not an atheist. I'm just agnostic. I have the coward's answer, the I don't know. So, you know, I think that if more people, I think the point is that Graham is at a battle with himself when he needs to accept both his faith and his lack of understanding as well. He could seek answers, but he can't let that consume him, is what it comes down to, I think. Right? Does that make sense at all?
Yeah, I mean, this is making me think about a lot of things, like what you just said about like seeking answers and having, you know, the process of science as you know, integrated parts of each other, because, you know, science is done by humans and humans have faith. So, you know, humans had to have faith that they could land on the moon in order for them to get to the moon or to get to the rockets that they attach to capsules that they attach to the lamb that got them to the moon. You know, it's like they had to have that human will and faith to get there. And so it's like a driving force behind what a human's trying to do. So like, you know, Graham throughout the whole thing is, you know, he's got that skepticism. He's got that almost not even a skepticism as antagonism. You know, he's kind of like he's antagonism. That's interesting. You know, he's got this sort of, the sort of dichotomy between himself and God, like as if he's like against God, as if he, you know,
the dinner scene, especially.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly where we go. But, but going back to faith, I mean, what I believe is that faith is part of being human. We can't know everything. We don't know everything because of the limitations of who we are as people, you know, and, you know, you only can consume as much sensory data as possible, but that's only so much. So you have to have faith that there are certain things that happen in the world and you have to go by feeling and gut with that. So it's like, you know, people are gonna, you know, there's nobody standing behind me. I don't have any evidence for that, but I have faith that I have, you know, the willingness and the capacity to understand that. But that's also saying that I rely on evidence. So it's like, we think of science and faith being at odds simply because faith means, you know, faith means you have the will and science means you have the way. So it's like, you know, it's rather than saying like evidence versus no evidence, it's more like human will and innovation and process, you know. So it's like these two human elements coming together can explode and create wonderful things, but they're separated so often. So it's like we separate these things. We separate the human, you know. I mean, if you say, you know, the Soviets are going to get to space before us, apparently we can build a rocket and go to the moon. I mean, that's like basically we use human faith and willpower to make things happen. So it's like,
yeah.
So, I mean, that's the train of thought that I'm going on. But as a person himself, coming back to faith, it's very interesting that it took a lot of evidence to get him there in a lot of ways, that he didn't have that gut feeling, or he almost had the gut feeling, but he bottled it up. Like he had the faith there, but he resented it in a way.
Yeah.
You know, and he bottled it up and didn't want to look at it because of this thing that happened to him and his wife. You know, it's like he didn't want to think of it. And then when he came back to the thing that happened, it kind of confirmed his faith. You know, when everything in the end ties together, he's like, you know, well, this goes back to my faith. And, you know, the fact that I have the faith, but I don't want it. And now it comes back to, you know, something traumatic and horrible that took away my faith has brought it back. Which is a lot of cases. And when a lot of people come back to faith is that some sort of traumatic or horrible thing happens to them and they come back to it.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. That's a fantastic line of thought, Bill. And that's the only reason I think that I would kind of reject any kind of demon reading of signs, is because without it, the story is just kind of a revelation story, which is all fine and dandy, but it kind of hollows it out. Whereas with the science aspect, with the extraterrestrials, with the science books will change forever, partnered with the battle of faith, I think it allows us to, it gives us a lot more to reach those kinds of conclusions and go down those lines of thought that a Revelations, a Rapture reading wouldn't.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could see that, yeah. It's much more human. It's much more human to go from the sci-fi, science, alien viewpoint.
Yeah, I mean, in an alien invasion, humans, you know, have a choice. Like, we could do something about it. In the Rapture, there's nothing we can do. There's nothing we could have ever done except pray. So, and if you mm-hmm. didn't start praying when you were out of the womb, you're done. So...
Right.
Well, it depends on what you believe.
True. I just mean in general. But, mm-hmm.
Well, no, that's kind of, actually, it's funny that you mentioned that. I was looking at the article that I had read about the allegory for demons and signs, and they claim that the primitive method of dispatching the aliens, you never really get to hear what it is, and so there's some speculation that it was prayer. And Graham's refusal to pray kind of allowed this thing to, you know, get a hold of his boy.
Huh. That's mm-hmm. interesting.
Yeah.
I like it. Like, don't get me wrong. I like it. I just, you know, it's just, I guess at the end of the day, it's all kind of moot because, like, if it was a Rapture reading, like, we wouldn't be talking mm-hmm. about it anyway. But it's
it might not necessarily be a Rapture reading, but it could just be a demon invasion rather than an alien invasion.
Well, if demons are coming onto Earth, isn't that just the Rapture? Like,
no. Did you ever see Constantine?
Right.
There's just a constant holy war going on between heaven and hell.
Oh, okay.
And sometimes things just happen. It doesn't necessarily mean that. Not only that, but people, God would pull all of his faithful off the earth before any crazy demon-y shit started happening on Earth. So you'd see those kids those kids would not be there. They would be gone.
Yeah.
Because they're innocent.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I wanted to say something. So, this is totally off base, but you talking about the little dwarf thing. Have you guys ever seen The Night Watch?
No.
I've seen Night Trap.
It's an insane Russian film that it was a Russian series, actually, and it's not within the wheelhouse of sci-fi, so I unfortunately can't go into it, but it's really cool.
Weird bard.
You should see
it. Is there a connection to what we're talking about, or is it just something that led you to think about it?
That's something that just led me to think about it, the battle between demons and angels and stuff like that. So, yeah, very cool movie. You can check it out because I was like thinking like, oh, maybe we should do that for the cast. And I was like, no.
We'll check it out and we'll talk about it on our next podcast, Religious Cross Sections, where we...
we'll pray about it. We'll, you know, read about it in the Bible. We'll tell you what we think about it.
We'll Bible study about it. Does anyone have any other points they want to talk about?
No, not really.
Wait, the 2004 one?
Yeah, 2004.
This almost like, is the tagline really cool as hell?
Probably. No, it was originally in Russian. It was originally in Russian, so they probably just like, and they barely translated it, so.
really quick side point. Do you guys think that, there could be a massive global coordination of crop circles?
I'm so glad you said that because I was just going to say that this movie was clearly made before the internet became a big thing.
I actually looked it up. So this movie came out in 2002 and 4chan was established in 2003.
So as Cherry Jones says, there is no way they could ever coordinate worldwide crop circles, period. No, there's zero way at that point in time. Eventually,
what if you got on alt.hoax.obsessive? You guys remember that?
No.
Me neither. I didn't have a computer in the 90s.
Okay.
But apparently there were no websites. There were just like... Not no websites as we know it.
The internet before... So before websites were invented, the internet was just dial tones. And people mm-hmm. would listen to the dial tones, and the different tones would give information.
Mm-hmm.
It was like a language.
Right. Like an alien language. Wrong,
but I don't know enough about it.
Like an alien language. That's right.
So are you saying the signed aliens were on AOL?
Is that why all
the, is that where all those AOL discs came from? Those trial discs?
The first...
When did they bury all those tubes?
Huh?
That's what I want to know.
I don't know. I think it's under Spielberg's house.
All the internet tubes?
Right next to the dead horses.
The dead horse ranch.
That was, I actually learned all about the internet tubes at a Blue Man Group concert.
Did they play the tubes? Is that why my internet keeps going in and out?
Yep, it's every time your internet's messing up, Blue Man Group is playing the tubes.
Fuck those dudes.
Yeah.
That's fun. No, there's no way there could ever be a worldwide coordination effort back then.
There could be now.
Now, definitely. And the fact that there hasn't been is ludicrous. We should do it.
They're just waiting for the 20th anniversary.
Man! If we were a bigger podcast, we could convince our fans to go out and start making crop circles in people's fields.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, 20 people listening right now.
Go out behind Mel Gibson's house and make fake crop circles.
And it would be big, and it would get us lots of media attention, and like we wouldn't be inciting a riot, so we wouldn't get in trouble.
Oh, yeah, local sci-fi really podcast tricks everybody into believing there's like a crop circles hoax, except for the fact that it's a sci-fi cross-sections, and it's not a crop circle.
George Lucas is reading the news?
He's gone a long way down.
It's his retirement.
He's fallen far.
Just a little bored.
Yeah. In other news, I wish I hadn't sold my major franchise to a bunch of fucking losers.
I wouldn't. $1 billion? You can make a whole fucking other franchise if you want to.
Something billion dollars.
He had, how many more ivory back scratchers is that? Five? Five more ivory back scratchers for Luke? Bassan?
Okay. If that's that... And it's time to go in to the best time of the night, because it means we're done. Good sci-fi, bad sci-fi! That's right, ladies and gentlemen, we are almost done, and you can almost stop listening to us. But first of all, we need to tell you whether
they
we think
they can never stop listening. Not to me.
He's always in your ear.
You can hear me in your head now. You'll hear all of your
first,
thoughts in my voice.
We need to tell you the word sci-fi along with an adjective in front of it, and we will use that method to describe our enjoyment of it. We may also use the word movie and an adjective in front of it.
Would you like to
beginning?
Start
then? Yeah, I'll start. Okay, I was going to start with you, but you took the initiative. I'm going to go ahead.
He just got a better role than you.
I'm going to go ahead and say it's okay, sci-fi. No, I want to say it's okay plus sci-fi. It like a C plus B minus. It's not bad. It's fine. The movie itself is not as good as I remember it being. It's not as spooky as I remember it being. But we had a good and thoughtful discussion about faith and humanity that came out of this, and I think that's worth something. So I won't say it's bad, and I won't say it's mediocre. It lacks certain aspects, but it does draw a good conversation out of us regarding faith, and I think that deserves a good minus sci-fi. Not a great movie. Mark? I'm sorry. Mark Circles.
I was thinking about the same. I think... It doesn't, you know, top the list for me or anything, but it was a bit better than I was expecting it to be. I didn't remember much about it, so I was kind of going in expecting it to not live up to what I had known of it. I do like... We did have a good discussion on it. I do like its tie to faith in sci-fi as a whole. I mean, a lot of genres of sci-fi, at least. And I like that kind of connection they made in that line they wrote. I think it's pretty good sci-fi.
All right. Thank you, Mark Circles. Mel Brooks, what do you got for us?
All right. Who is obviously the star of this film? I would say that it is... Okay, so when I started this, when I was going to go watch it, I was thinking Bad Sci-Fi. And now that we've started talking about it, I'm going to go with what Ben said, which is like a check minus check sort of thing if we were in elementary school. I'm going to go with that. It made me ask a lot of good questions, which is my sort of test for this. So it made me ask some questions about being human, which I know Colin would appreciate. So yeah, I'll give it right in the middle. I'll give it okay sci-fi, which is not good or bad. So I'm breaking the rules because I'm a bad boy.
I mean, as long as you have an adjective in front of the word sci-fi, we're good. So that's all we require.
I'm the wild card of the group.
We've done okay sci-fis plenty of times. All right. And the always consistent Hawk Braxton.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat. It's just kind of bleh, kind of meh sci-fi. It's fine. Like I said, it's kind of just one step away from not being sci-fi at all, just because of the nature of the monster. It's a good idea to examine what it means to be human, at least from time to time. Maybe not have it constantly in the forefront of your mind, because that's enough to make you go crazy. But every once in a while, just be like, what am I doing here? I'm in a big rock hurtling through space for, if you're unlucky, 28 years. If you're real lucky, then maybe something closer to 80 or 90. Good, bleh, just kind of meh, blah, 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 sci-fi. How do you spell that?
Word.
I want to address that you keep saying that if they took the sci-fi out of the movie, it wouldn't be sci-fi.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you could take the, it's the same kind of thing. Like, if you took Event Horizon out of space, it's a good movie. It's a good, it's a haunted house movie in space. If you take the alien out of the movie Alien, then it's nothing. It's not a movie anymore at all. At that point, it's just like it's Sigourney Weaver just running around through the air ducts.
It's just a weird voyeuristic, like, experimental film.
Can I? I wanna, no one likes maybe it. Maybe I'll recut Alien with no alien. Game over, man.
A special presentation from Sci-Fi Cross Sections and editor Andrew W.S. Miller.
Yeah. We'll put it out like
no
a riff track.
No alien. I'd love to watch it. I'd love to watch it and then come together and talk about it and maybe dissect it.
The Andrew Miller minus alien cut.
Speaking of which, as so long as there are no surprises like Tenet last week, next week we are talking about the Robert Pattinson indie sci-fi film High Life. All that talk about Tenet and Robert Pattinson made me want to remind everyone that Robert Pattinson is good at what he does. I've always wanted to see it. I haven't gotten to see it yet, so I hear he's great in it. I'm really excited about it. And I love indie sci-fi too. I think we all do. I think we all prefer indie sci-fi than these big budgets.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we filled out our schedule through October. I'm not going to tell y'all what's coming just yet in case something changes, but rest assured it's good. We got two TV shows on the list, a bunch of classics, a bunch of 80s classics, and some new stuff. So it's really exciting. But most importantly, we're not going to keep doing this if you don't find us listeners. So go subscribe, go review us, go share us with your friends, be an active supporter of the podcast, and we will reward you for it.
Tell them what they won, Ben.
Huh?
Tell them what they can win.
How many Ben points would they get?
We should do a giveaway. Let's come up with a giveaway. If you have something you think would be like fun to do for like a giveaway, like a a prize or something, like, post it to our Facebook page, like, shoot us a message, like, if you have an idea, let us know, like, what kind of prizes are you people looking for out here? Are you looking for movie tickets? Are you looking for signed posters of movies, but with our autographs on it?
I will personally sign every copy of the poster for Event Horizon out there.
Do you want Bill to come? Do you want Bill to come
shirtless
party?
To your birthday party?
He'll scream a lot and he'll be really confused.
He will rub his chest on the glass.
I don't understand. He started talking about satellites for 30 minutes.
But in all seriousness, very seriously, please, please be active members. We know you're out there listening, and we appreciate you for that so much. But you know, we need to see some growth, and we're working on it on our end. But we also need your help on your end. So please, I know you have a friend that would be interested in this. Please just sit them down and force them to listen to the Valerian episode. It'll hook them every time. The Valerian episode. That's the one.
My kids need wine.
I got nothing else. Thank you so much. Stay safe, stay healthy. And as our overlord would say, until next time.